What's going on, everybody? Welcome to week 18 of the NFL season, the last week of the regular season, and it's going to be kind of a shit show, which is what always happens. We're going to have some things to figure out. We're going to have to look at some standings. We're going to have to talk about who's playing for what, whether some of the teams that aren't playing for anything are going to give it their all or play all their guys the time we think. It's going to be a wild one, so keep that in mind. I've actually preferred these weeks. I've done well on them in the past, so I like the speculative slates, and I think that's going to be a lot of that. So Sheets, any sort of overall thoughts before we jump into
games? Yeah, I do. So in addition to what Bobby said about team motivation, there, I'm sure at some point there'll be a comprehensive report put out about individual motivations for like contract stuff about different bonuses and incentives and things like that. And I guess it's safe to say that we're beyond the point that, you know, I remember in the movie in Eight Men Out when they held back Eddie Seacott's like last four starts to stop him from getting 30 wins, because if he got 30 wins, he was going to get a bonus or something like that.
Right.
I presume that we're beyond that, and the teams are actually helping their guys get the bonuses. They don't need to piss the players off at this point. So at some point, I don't expect you to have all that in front of you right now, but at some point, maybe we'll put out some kind of list of guys that might be playing for something that's attainable. You know, let's say, ooh, we got to make sure that, Christian McCaffrey is in there for every snap because he's only 380 yards away from some record. You know what I mean? Like, it's not like that. My overall take, and again, I'm making this up, right? This is just my instinct of how to handle this. Is there are two types of guys that you're gonna wanna I would play, and one group that I don't feel like playing. The groups I want to play are either teams and players that are playing for something, that you know they're gonna get their roles, that are healthy, that are gonna be in there the whole time, that you can project, that are playing for all their stuff. That's one. The other group that I will play are guys that are the reserve substitutes that no one's heard of, that are 4K, that are getting huge roles because everybody's being rested, right? So whatever the names of these people are, and I probably have never heard of any of them, but if XYZ gets ruled out for XYZ team at running back, and XYZ gets ruled in as like a rookie who wants to show what he can do and he's 4K, I mean, I'll play that also. Right.
Right.
The guys I don't want to play are the guys with these kind of hazy motivations, you know, like guys that, well, he's going to play. We're going to start our guys, even though we don't have to, you know, those types of guys I want no part of, because they'll start the game, but at any moment, you know, they're not going to get their 30 carries. They're not going to get their 15 targets. And God forbid, like they even like come up limping on one play, they're out, you know, and they're just not going to run these guys into the ground, even if they're going to play. So I think those are the plays that are bad. Like the plays that I'll throw one out. Like, let's say Tampa announces that they're going to play all their guys or something like that. I have no interest in like any of it. You know what I mean? I don't believe it. I don't believe it. I believe they'll play all their guys, but that doesn't, listen, if you tell me that you're going to play an NBA player, it's quite different than saying that he has, you know, might have a minutes limit. You know what I mean? Like it's different. So overall, that's my grouping. I'll play the guys that I know are going to head out. I'll play the guys that I know are playing for nothing, but are just so cheap and are going to get their roles. Mm-hmm. Whoever that is, I'll play that. But everything in the middle, I think, is the fade for me.
Yep. I totally agree with everything you said. With that said, let's pull up the thing and we'll go game by game here.
Okay.
And I'm going to have my little odds calculated for NBA playoff odds up on my right of my thing.
NFL?
NFL, excuse me. Because there is certain paths for some of these teams to get there in some weird ways, and it's kind of annoying, but we'll get into it. Most people are pretty locked into their spots. So the first game is the Tampa Bay Atlanta game, right?
Yep.
I am probably going to do nothing that
You don't want to play Algier?
On the Tampa, well, I was going to say on
the
Tampa.
Oh, okay. I thought you were saying nothing the whole game. Okay.
I don't like the matchup for Algier. Drake London is probably my favorite play on the Atlanta side. And I'm okay with Algier, but I would prefer maybe getting to London this week. That's where I'm at.
Yeah, I kind of think that the matchup is fine on this particular occasion. I think that the not going 100% applies to the defense also. You could argue, and it's not a personnel thing because they whatever, but you could argue that playing like 100% tough defense is pretty freaking hard. And if you have not much to go on, not much to play for, maybe you don't get whatever Tampa Bay defense even exists. And Tyler Algier, he's been showing out. He's been, you know, he's been doing better. I only almost wonder if, you know, they don't want to overwork him, you know, because, you know, he's apparently the future over there, right? Now, they're out of it, right, Atlanta? I presume.
Yeah, they're done.
Yeah. So maybe he doesn't get like 100, you know, 30 rushes or anything like that. But, hey, it'd be nice to get, you know, it definitely be nice to end your season at home again on a good note against the Bucks and Tom Brady, you know, maybe against Tom Brady. So I like Algier. London is you know, I had him last week. I guess go back to that. I think Algier and London, and I'm gonna be off of the Tampa stuff.
Yep, same page here. But you know, by the time this game comes around, we might even have different players playing for Tampa. Like, I know they'd like to win, have a winning regular season. I think they probably play their starters for a half. That's my guess. All right, New England Buffalo, a game that actually does matter to Buffalo and New England. This is kind of a big one, but hard to find from a DFS, like all too exciting. Like Jacoby Myers is certainly in play. Hunter Henry for New England. Ramondre Stevenson, I think, is in play, but it's a tough matchup. So those are my favorite plays, and it's kind of weird that they're on the New England side. I don't mind taking a shot on Gabe Davis here, or Stephon Diggs for that matter. So I'm okay with it, but it's certainly not my favorite game. How do you feel about it?
Is New England in anything or no?
New England, yeah, they got a chance to make the playoffs.
Yeah.
They need help, but
I think that and this is a horrific, it's a pretty horrific take, but I like New England against the spread here.
I don't think it's horrific at all.
Yeah, I think Buffalo's gonna obviously come out with just tons of freaking emotion, you know, after what they've been through, you know, and the crowd's gonna be just ballistic, right? You know, they'll have obviously a ceremony and all this stuff. You know, it's gonna be quite. And listen, I've been anti sweating Belichick for like how many Super Bowls? You know what I mean?
Right.
And you know that he's in his freaking locker room saying, "I don't give an F about the Bills. I don't give an F about the guy who's in the hospital." You know what I mean? Like, all I'm thinking about is how to take advantage of all this, what's going on in the emotion. I need a win. And I don't care about anything else in this universe. And that's why he's won 100 Super Bowls, right? So I think he's going to come up with something. I think he's going to – I think that they're going to play a very, very good game. So I do like them plus – what is that, 7? I do like them plus the 7 in this game.
Yeah.
Now, I will say that according to my sheets here, I have Buffalo rated as actually, believe it or not, like a top stack on the board at 14 games. Considering value and all this stuff, I can't imagine why, but that's the kind of slate it is, I suppose. So I mean, listen, you look at the other way, and New England is you know, they're obviously always good defensively, but you got Buffalo playing for something at home, you know, that's a situation I probably want to have a piece of. So I will I'll get on the good side of the karma there probably and play some Buffalo. And played to Josh Allen and Diggs and Gabe Davis and all that stuff. And kind of like it. I haven't even looked yet. How does Ramondre Stevenson look? I mean,
he's not going to project well, but yeah. It's a good Buffalo defense. And you did have, you know, more carries going to Harris last week than we sort of would have expected. But I still like him. And I think that's what I would do. Is I'm not prioritizing this game. If I was going to stack Buffalo, I'd run it back with two. But I think all of Myers, and I forgot to mention Tyquan Thornton as a value play, even with Devontae Parker possibly back, one of Thornton or Parker. I think that really trying to get one of Stevenson, Myers, Hunter Henry, Thornton, or Parker, or two of those guys in the stack, if you're going to stack Buffalo, makes sense. And then Gabe Davis and Stephon Diggs are my favorite plays from Buffalo. No surprise. I don't think they're going to be owned particularly this week. So just something to keep in mind. I do like those. I can be talked into this, even though I don't really want to game stack it desperately. All right, so, next up.
So Minnesota, Chicago. So for this game to matter to Minnesota, okay, they would need to win and San Francisco to lose to Arizona as a 100-point favorite. Okay.
Right.
Now they're smart. I mean, they segment, you know, they put these games apart from each other. You know, Minnesota doesn't get that free look, you know. However, listen, I love my Giants and all, but if Minnesota stays the three, they get to play the Giants. Where if they go up to two, it probably plays like the Packers or something like that. I'd rather play the Giants if you want to know the truth. But I don't believe a word of this, not a word of this, but I don't think Minnesota, first of all, I think Minnesota stinks. Okay. Second of all, I'm not convinced that they play all their guys either. I'm not even convinced Cousins plays. It's just something that you just gonna have to obviously look for. This could end up being one of those situations where Alexander Mattison is the big chalk on the slate. But if Dalvin Cook maybe gets ruled out or something like that, if they're really going to go that route, maybe even Madison wouldn't get all the work. But I would take my chances at 5,100. You could play Madison just blind, you know, play Madison at 5,100. It's probably not the worst play anyway. And let's just say that, you know, that they decide that after like a half, they're like, I don't want any part of this anymore. And they pull Cook for the second half. That's good enough. You know, I think.
Right.
So I like that. The problem here with Chicago is that they're not playing Justin Fields. They're going to be playing, what is it, Nathan Peterman?
Mm-hmm.
And that's just not good. what you're going to get, I mean, though, is you're going to get 37, you know, carries out of the backfield. You know, whoever that is, between Montgomery and Herbert, they're going to get probably a billion runs against a team that is not that good. They're just not Minnesota. Yeah. So I would play either or both of them. Obviously, I wouldn't play both of them in the same lineup, but I think that Montgomery and or Herbert both make sense. I'm not going to do the Minnesota thing. I'm just not going to play them.
Yeah, I hate to say it, but I completely disagree about the Minnesota take. This is of all teams in football, the home field advantage means the most to them of anybody, and it's not even close. Cousins is terrible on the road, especially outdoors. He's just a terrible outdoor quarterback, and I think getting the home field is a big deal over the Niners here. So having to not play that game, I also think that you're setting yourself up for a better matchup in the first round. I don't see any reason, you know, that like, it is true that you can assume the Niners are just going to win and that be that. But like, we just saw Jarrett Stidham almost beat the Niners. The Niners still have a quarterback who's only played five games. I think they'll try to win this game. But again, this is my speculation too. So that meaning that I'm going to be high on Dalvin Cook. I'm going to be high on Justin Jefferson. And I'm going to probably be high on Hawkinson as well. I don't like playing Cousins in the outdoors, so I'm not going to play a stack, but I do want to get pieces of this game. I think they will try to win, at least as of right now, Thursday morning. That's my take. I have nothing on the Chicago side that I can even think about. I really don't even know what I would have to do to play any of the receivers. And both running backs, yeah, it's a good spot. What is the, you know, Montgomery's getting older. What is their motivation? Are they going to just cut ties and let him go? I don't really know. He projects really well. So it's kind of tricky, but I do think that all the guys on Minnesota are definitely in play for me.
Well, if you think that, I would imagine Minnesota is going to be a huge chalk defense, right? I mean,
I would imagine they would as well. 2,900. Yeah, they should. Well, I don't know about huge shock, but they should be fairly.
It'll be a great play. It'll be a great play.
I like that. I agree with that. Men defense is already on my list. All right. You ready to move on?
Yep.
All right. Jump us over to the Baltimore Cincinnati game, which is the Cincinnati and the Buffalo game are just so hard to understand. Like, cause they do.
I don't think this one's that hard to understand. I think Cincinnati beats the crap out of them. That's my understanding of this game. Cincinnati puts up a zillion points and Baltimore can't do anything. That's my initial take. And I have Cincinnati rated as a very, very strong stack. Burrow, Chase, Higgins, Hurst, Mixon, all of it. That's where I am. And I'm not, if you want to run something back with Baltimore, yeah, Andrews makes the most sense to me. That's just kind of where I am. What is there? Cincinnati, they could use a win, obviously, right? I don't think Baltimore is any good at all. So that's my take. Play the Cincinnati guys, take the 35-0 and go.
We're going to take a tiny different again. I completely disagree when you say
Baltimore. I love it. This is great. I love it.
I don't understand this the way that people talk about this Baltimore team. They're missing.
Oh, no, I did it. I did it.
They're missing one of the best five players in football all year. And all they've done is just keep winning games 16-13 and 17-10 and all that stuff. I actually think that like Tyler Huntley's in play. Let's go.
Okay.
Since I just feel kind of, but I don't necessarily like, I still think that Cincinnati will win this game and everything, but I just think that Baltimore is getting a lot of like unfair criticism because they have had nobody healthy. They have no receivers healthy. They have their quarterback hasn't been healthy for a long time now. And J.K. Dobbins is sort of playing on one leg. It's not going to stop me from trying to stack this game up a little bit. And I'm just double checking for the Ravens if they actually, like, what guys would that even mean they would rest if they were, you know, just going to be happy with their current playoff spot. And that's what I'm dealing with it because I do think this is an interesting little stack. If you know, you could play the expensive guys if you play the cheap Huntley at quarterback. And I know that sounds really, really shaky, but it's just an early look that I have. I guess technically since the Ravens, you know, could still tie for the division with Cincinnati if that Buffalo game ever gets played. So you'd think the Ravens would bring it here. But there's a chance that they don't. So it's a very speculative game. I do like Dobbins. It's really hard for me to know who I would even want to pair Huntley with because this is pretty, pretty grim. DeMarcus Robinson or Mark Andrews would be the logical answer. I do think Andrews on his own is a pretty strong play against Cincinnati, who you can get over the middle a little bit. And then I like this. I do think the Cincinnati passing game is fully in play as a potential stack, including Hayden Hurst at tight end and Jamar Chase, T. Higgins, and Boyd in that order. I think they're all in play. So I do like this as a little bit of a potential stack, possibly. Just keep in mind, these games tend to be very, very ugly and low scoring. But Cincinnati's offense, when they're clicking, they can put up points against anybody. So
I think Higgins is obviously going to be playing with a lot of emotion based on this past Monday. If he doesn't get ruled out completely, you want to know the truth. I wouldn't blame him either.
Yeah, he's like the one you want to fade, if anything, right? Like a lot of emotion might be a bad thing.
Yeah, I also wouldn't be surprised if he didn't play at all. So we'll see what happens. But that's where I am there. Oh, and here comes a real, real fun one. Houston at Indianapolis.
Jesus.
This is the one that's going to win the slate, right? Not with any of my money on it, but probably someone's going to win from this game just because I just don't want anything here. I mean, look, Pierce, maybe. I just have nothing here for you. You like anything here?
I think Brandon Cooks is fine, and if not Brandon Cooks, you can play Chris Moore. They're cheap, you know, receivers that are reasonable-ish. I don't know how much they're going to play Cooks here. Indy, man, I don't know what to do with Indy. They are at home, last game of the season. You think they try to play well?
Saturday's, you know, he's auditioning, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah. Zach Moss though, or Deion Jackson, I guess that Moss is looking like a really good play at 5,200. And I think that that Pittman is in play, but nothing I'm overly excited about here.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I can't decide what to do with Houston if I want to do anything at all. So probably just going to move on past that one.
So apparently, the Jets quarterback situation is taking the reverse pivot now. Mike White is not the second coming, and apparently the coach says, "Oh, we're going to be riding with Zach Wilson." Hey, how about that? I will say this: Zach Wilson is 4,800. I hate to say this, but that's good enough for me. Wait a minute. He's now a healthy inactive. Wait a minute. They just said, this is so funny. He won't use a mostly meeting team. Not look at Wilson. So they are going to start White. He just had a quote saying we're going to be grinding with Wilson. All right. Mike White at 5,300. I'm just going to say the same. That's a really cheap price for a quarterback of the NFL in general. And it's a cheap price for a guy that's got receivers that people like to play. You know, like a lot of like play Garrett Wilson. People like to play Elijah Moore. He's a good play. The tight end, Conklin's very playable. And I don't know, this total seems low. I don't know. You have Miami with I don't know who exactly is going to be quarterback now. who is going to be quarterback?
Probably either Bridgewater or Skylar Thompson.
Probably Skylar Thompson, I think.
Yeah.
Well, let me ask you a dumb question: Is are Hill and Waddle out somehow?
No.
So you have a quarterback at 4,900 with like two of the top like 10 receivers in the league, probably. Mm-hmm. You're close.
In a game they need to play.
I don't know. Maybe this is a game. And listen, we talk about weather. I don't know what the weather's like anywhere else. I promise you this. It's nice in Miami. So is this the worst stack in the world? I guess we're going to find out. I'll probably have to do some of this.
Yeah, I think that this game makes sense as like an interesting like long shot low owned stack. I mean, Miami's playing for their playoff lives. It is concerning with the Jets just being eliminated from the playoffs. What they're gonna do? I think they'll try it. I think they'll come out and try to win. But it would make me feel better if they were at home. I think Zonovan Knight is a fringy running back play. I think Garrett Wilson, assuming that he plays, is it?
Wait, hang on. Is this line right? Are the Jets favored?
Yeah, Miami, I mean, they've lost six in a row, right?
But the Dolphins are playing for a playoff spot.
Yeah, but the Jets, I mean, the Jets, they're assuming the Jets are going to play, I guess.
Right, you know? And they're at home, and they're getting, wow, this is amazing.
Well, I mean, it's not surprising to me. I think that actually, even last week, the Jets would have been like a favorite here. I don't think it's like a lasting thing of the season.
I like this game for DFS. I like this.
Okay. Well, I can get on board with that. You know, especially if it's, I feel better about it if it's Bridgewater, even though he hasn't looked very promising. But Bridgewater, Tyreek Hill, especially maybe Jalen Waddle, and then you know Wilson on the other side, potentially Bam Knight. I think that's a reasonable stack right there. So I'm open to it. It's not my favorite, but I'm definitely open to it. And now we're into the afternoon games, right? Okay, so then we've got the other ones.
We got two more.
Oh, sorry, my bad.
Two more ones. Carolina, New Orleans.
Yeah, Carolina, New Orleans. Go ahead, Chiefs.
You noticed if Alvin Kamara's played this year? He's played, right?
Yeah, he's playing. He's playing.
Just kidding. I mean, like, in general, this whole season. Yeah. He had one really good game. I remember. So the Saints are coming off a nice win. I have Rashid Shaheed for better or worse as the top point per hour skill player on the slate. actually tied with two other guys. One of them is Rashid Shaheed, for better or for worse. This just look, it's a dome, so that's something. But it's Andy Dalton, so that's something else. And on the other side of this, what do we have? We're going to go back to this running game with Foreman. Oh, boy, I don't know. I'm not too inspired by anything in this game.
Yeah, Shaheed will be one of the most popular plays on the slate. With all the injuries to the secondary of Carolina, as I mentioned last week, which was my reason for getting on to Tampa Bay. I think this is. I think Dalton is completely stackable with Olave and Shaheed. The thing that sucks is that we have Taysom Hill in our lives.
Yep. Also, stack just the receivers there, right? I mean, like.
Yeah. Then what are we doing with the 40? It's 4,800 quarterback in the better of spots, you know.
Right.
And you know, sadly, it is what it is. I don't think I'm going to end up playing Kamara because I know that he's actually got a future in the league and they have nothing to play for. But he is showing up as a good point per dollar play. But right now, mostly it's just the wide receivers, Olave and Shaheed for me. I can't really get to much on Carolina, to be honest with you. And even the New Orleans side, I still feel very questioning of what I want to do. And there's two ways you could play the slate. We'll get into it in a minute with the afternoon games, because if you wait for the afternoon games, some of those games may become irrelevant by the end of this. So it's you have to figure out what you're going to do with your stacks if they become irrelevant. But anyway, it's just a little bit tricky. But I do think Shaheed and Olave on their own are just really, really strong plays. So I like both those guys a ton, and that is most of my exposure to this game. I'll probably throw a Dalton stack in.
Okay.
All right. Next, you have the Cleveland-Pittsburgh, right?
Yeah. So I like awesome for Pittsburgh, man. I mean, good for them.
Yeah.
Actually playing for a playoff berth. I mean, they need a lot of help, whatever, but
right. –
What's their record, Pittsburgh?
Pittsburgh's 8-8.
Like, what's his name? Tomlin has never had a losing record.
Yeah, he's the Mr. 500 plus.
Maybe he just won't play hard this game. That's funny.
Yeah, right.
So I like Najee Harris at 6,100. And I think I like the Pittsburgh side of this. I don't really have too much for the Cleveland side. But I will take my chances with a little bit of Najee Harris. Again, I know he's going to play hard. You know what I mean? Like, I know I'm getting whatever I'm getting from him. And I don't know if I quite have it in me to stack the Pittsburgh side with, say, Pickett. But it's another one, 5K. I mean, this is it's kind of egregious, right? And Pickens...
But Pickett never gets there. Like, he hasn't had one game more. I don't think he scored 20
even for 5K.
Well, I don't think he's ever scored 20 fantasy points before.
Yeah, I guess not.
So if we're gonna talk about him, like, Dalton should be way ahead of him.
So Deontay Johnson, like, just, you know, is a right around double digit targets every game though. Questionable though. Yeah, okay. I make what's his name my favorite play, the Najee Harris. Although I will say that this guy Warren does get work. As a matter of fact, what is it, 12? Got 12 rushes in the last game. Three targets too. Wow, I didn't realize it's that much. Yeah, maybe not. Maybe it's just, but then again, Najee had 22 carries. So.
Yeah, it just they ran the ball.
Yeah, I like Najee Harris.
Yeah, typical thing for Pittsburgh for me. I will try to force in a Harris, Johnson, or Pickett. I don't have any particular love for any of them. They're all cheap enough. I'm sorry, Pickens, I should say. I think that my favorite, if I had to pick one, would probably be Deontay Johnson, but I'm totally good with using Najee Harris this week. It is a good defense that they're facing, probably a little bit overlooked, or better defense than people think, I should say. Mari Cooper's questionable. which would open up potentially, like, David Bell might actually end up having some ownership. I'm not as excited by the Cleveland side of it, but I do think playing one of those three from Pittsburgh is a good idea, because they get, you know, they just get all the work basically. And I guess Freiermuth would be in that mix also. So one of Harris, Johnson, Pickett, and Freiermuth, with Johnson being my favorite.
I think it's you want to move on?
Yeah, this is a tough slate.
Giants, Philly. So Giants are locked in, and they are playing Philly, who finally have to win. And they are 100-point underdog on the road. So there's a couple of ways this can go, you know, like the Giants do what they're supposed to do and just not do anything in this game. You might end up getting like a whole bunch of 3K guys that you might have to decide on. Their receivers are already thin, right? But at least we've decided that it's Slayton, Hodgins, and James are like the three guys. But if it's rest time for these guys, then literally every other receiver on their board is 3K. Okay, that's one thing.
Yeah.
Second of all, if they decide, as they should, that Barkley should rest, you have some combination of Matt Breida and Brightwell, the most expensive of which is 5K. You could even argue that Breida, they wouldn't want to waste him either. Like, you know what I mean?
Right.
So maybe Brightwell, it becomes like the lead guy. And yeah, so, okay. So I'll get to the Philly in a second, but part of me just doesn't believe that they're going to ever tank a game to Philadelphia. And we talk about this a lot, you know, and there's just so much freaking history with these teams that even though they're not supposed to do this, we talked about this yesterday, I forget, but even though it's like probably the dumbest thing in the world to do, like, I think they might like play their guys and try to win. You know what I mean? I just stick it to Philadelphia somehow. You know what I mean? Like, I don't even know if they have it. They could do it if they tried, but I'm not going to play them, like the top guys, like Barkley or whatever, but just, I wouldn't be surprised if that's the way it went. On the Philly side, if they put up like a number in the first quarter or two or whatever, I can't imagine like them playing Miles Sanders in the second half.
So they better be up huge then. Like, they'd have to be like four touchdown lead or something.
Well, but the point is that what I'm saying is that they're the drop. I mean, using Kenneth Gainwell is not bad. You know what I mean?
Right.
And they'll try to get away with it. You know what I mean? They'll try to get away with a split share between Sanders, Gainwell, and even Boston Scott for as long as possible, I think. And I not sure what's going to happen with Jalen Hurts. I presume he plays. I just don't think Giants.
No. Jalen Hurts is definitely not playing.
He's not playing?
I can't imagine he's playing. Like, I mean, it's the same thing we hear every week, but every analyst I've heard talk about Jalen Hurts thinks he's even questionable for the divisional round. Like, I don't
know about that. Okay, we'll see.
But you're reading of this. These are not real things. He practiced. He's been a limited participant at practice the last 4 weeks.
Okay.
Playing over the last 3 weeks.
So I'm probably, listen, for all the reasons I mentioned earlier about the types of teams and the types of situations I want a part of, I probably will be off of this game.
I see this as actually, though, the opposite. I mean, Philadelphia desperately needs to win. Like, this is not even a question. You can't lose this game. This would put a real damper. I mean, and look, if Hurts comes in magically, they decide to play him, to try to, you know, if they weren't two touchdown favorites already, like, maybe they would consider it if it was a really tough game, because I do think winning the division really, really matters, obviously. But man, I mean, I like the Philly stack with Minshew anyway. So I'm happy to do that. And I will play Devontae Smith as my primary target, with Goddard being the next most desirable, followed by AJ Brown. And I have no interest in anything from the Giants, unless we get the official Barkley is out thing. The thing about with the Giants doing that is, like, yeah, while they might not want to give Philly anything and go into Philly, like, they hate Dallas just as much, and then they'd be helping Dallas out. So I don't really know, you know what I mean? It's a tough,
right.
tough one, but I hear you. You know what I mean? That did occur to me as well. But why would they, like, they haven't been in the playoffs in a while. They're competitive. They got a lot of good stuff going. Maybe you just let this one go if you're them, right? Wouldn't you think that's the logical thing to do?
Yep. Absolutely.
Yeah. All right. So then we get another matchup where, you know, with Dallas, right?
Yep.
So Dallas, the problem is, so, you know, this is why they play these games at the same time. Dallas obviously would need to win if Philadelphia were to lose somehow to get the division and the bye. As of right now, nothing is really showing up for me with Dallas, with the exception of Gallup and Noah Brown as low-owned cheapos. I do think McLaurin is in play as a low-owned play. I'm curious what Washington does. It's a division game. Makes me think that they'll try and go out on a good note.
Absolutely.
So I kind of like this one. I like Brian Robinson. I'm going to get some exposure to this game for sure. It's just, I don't know if I have a lot of the, like, I guess Zeke is the main one for Dallas, but like, I don't love the Dallas place, but I really do like the Washington side of things.
Dude, what's going to happen in this game? I just thought I'd let you know this, is that this game is going to end up being Jay Williams season or Jared Patterson season, because Brian Robinson has been absent from practice.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And with Gibson on injured reserve and Washington with nothing to play for, whatever. I don't know if Brian Robinson is even in town. I don't know what's going on with him, but you're going to get a 4,300, 4,000, somebody like that. I think this is going to be one of those chalky cheapos. I think we'll see. I think whoever starts at running back for Washington, I like. How about that? If Brian Robinson does show up and he's ready to go, I'll go with that. Otherwise, whoever coach speak you like from the other guys, I'd probably just go with whoever the field just kind of agrees on. You know what I mean? Like, between all the people that are looking into it, you know what I mean? Like, if somebody from this game is probably going to be chalky, it's probably for a reason. But I do like Washington plus the spread against the spread regardless, and I like McLaurin regardless. You have a team like Dallas, it's going to be sort of scoreboard watching. It's usually just a bad situation to be in. You know what I mean? Like, you're just not getting your best game, I don't think. And I like Washington.
I do too. Yeah. So we're on the same page. I do think if you're going to force in the run back though, from Dallas, I forgot to mention, I guess T.Y. Hilton is sort of mucking things up for these other guys, but one of these cheapos is going to end up staying on the field. You'd think it would probably be Noah Brown. I think Brown, Gallup, and Hilton, I think you can make an argument for all those guys as run backs if you wanted to play two players from like a McLaurin and whoever the running back is for Washington. Because I do think it's really valuable. But I would rather try and attack Dallas through the air. So I do like that McLaurin call. And by the way, we always say McLaurin, but I should probably mention that Dotson's really like starting to make more plays out there. And I'm a big fan of this guy's talent. So definitely want to get some Dotson as well. I do like the Washington side here quite a bit. So, all right. Next up, we have Chargers Denver, right?
Yep.
So what do we think that the Chargers are going to do here? I don't think that they're going to play anybody full run. I don't think it makes enough of a difference for them to. So I'm probably going to be off of this, not to mention Denver's got a pretty good defense as it is. They sort of have found their offense a little bit more lately. I think Cortland Sutton is too cheap at 4,800. So probably Sutton as my favorite play in this game and pretty much not getting to anything else. How about you?
Yeah. So what I think that Wilson and these guys for Denver are actually going to get some ownership. Mm-hmm. They just put up, a good game, you know. What's the deal with the Chargers? They sort of locked in?
So the Chargers are, I'm trying to see what they could move to. I guess they could get a higher seed than the Ravens, which I don't think matters all that much.
Well, So I'll say this. You know, I said it before the Denver's game last week. I said, listen, the teams always play well after the coaches get fired or better, right? They came out pretty inspired last week, and I think they're going to come out inspired this week. And I do like Denver quite a bit in this game against the spread. You know what? Why not? I mean, Wilson with the two receivers that we like, and who's the tight end? Is he still around? Or is he? Oh no, you get the Albert O at 2,900. Oh yeah, you got to do all this, right? So yeah, so that I like Wilson, and this is another kind of category of team nothing to play for, but you know they're going to play hard anyway. You know, it's like there's no way that they don't show up for this game. Whatever they have, I don't know what they have exactly, but I think whatever they have, they're going to be playing hard. I mean, their last home game against the division rival, you know, the thing is, they haven't been playing for anything the whole season, pretty much, you know, so it's not like anything new, you know what I mean? So they're just going to play. So I like it. I like the Denver side. And you want to play Chargers? I got no problem with that. You want to play Keenan Allen? You want to play Mike Williams? You want to play Eckler? Yeah, I think for a stupid 39 total, I think this is legit. Wow.
Why would they be playing those? I mean, I'm pretty sure Vegas is counting on them in the sitting. There's no reason why Denver's favored in this game.
So they are locked in.
Vegas is going to count on. Vegas is counting on it, so I'll count on it.
I guess
they're not going to play more than a half. I can't see how or why they would, considering especially they had injuries and all that stuff. But if any of these guys are announced out, I would get on to DeAndre Carter. Because it, you know, if you get the other receivers out, I think Carter could have a big game here. If Everett's out, maybe Donald Parham becomes in the mix. If Eckler's out, Joshua Kelly. But I just think overall, I'm sort of passing on that thing. I do think Denver comes to play for this one, though. So I don't mind getting that stack. I just don't have the Chargers that I really want to run it back with. And boy, it's pretty ugly when in week 18, the worst offense in the recent history of football is the team we're talking about stacking. And they've only been good against the only team they've been good against all season. They've had two good games offensively, and they've been against Kansas City. So I'm not too high on it, but I do think that it definitely is in play. It's a little lower for me than the other stacks that I like. But to be honest, I don't really like a lot this week. I think that I might just feel good about getting the Philadelphia stack and just sort of hammering that home. I really do. I really might do it. All right. What do you got next? You got looks like the Arizona San Francisco game. All of these, you know, Arizona will, with what guys they have, I think try to do their best. And look, you've got Dortch at 3,800. I don't care if you let me down last week. I'll go back to that. I think Marquise Brown is in play. The Giants have obviously the Niners have a really good defense. But I'm not going to let that dictate everything here. So I'll have a little bit of Dortch and a little bit of Marquise Brown. And on the San Francisco side, you're going to have an incredibly chalky and probably for pretty good reason, Christian McCaffrey. I think that's clearly where if you're playing cash games, you're playing Christian McCaffrey. I don't think there's really much thought goes into that one. And I think that the other ones, though, that no one's going to play the receivers because of the game script issues. Maybe getting to some Kittle and especially some Ayuk is a good idea. So that's all I got here.
Nothing on Arizona?
Arizona's, I said Dortch and Marquise Brown.
Yeah, so Dortch is one of the other strong point per dollar plays I had alongside with Shahid at 3,800. Just to throw it out there, San Francisco, I think that they're I mean, they need to win, right? But again, they're also a big favorite. I don't want to play. I don't think I want to play McCaffrey in the big field GPP. I think his price is just it's really high for a game where, listen, could have said it last week, right? Like last week, people were like, well, is he really gonna need to put up a ceiling performance again when they're a big favorite against the Raiders, and you saw what happened, right? Then again, like the Raiders had like legitimate offense, like to
yeah,
offer.
Yeah.
And this game, I think, is going to be more of you know what this game is going to be. You see this implied total. This looks like the final score if you want to know the truth. You know, it looks like 27-13. Like that's probably given very little variance. I'm telling you, I think this is exactly where this game kind of like lands. And I don't know. I get maybe. I may maybe you could afford the 9,500 and pay. And you know, listen, you'll be able to afford it because of all the value that's going to show up, right? I don't know who it's going to be, right. but you could definitely afford. Maybe you know it goes back to our NBA discussion. Maybe because he does have that ceiling, that's what you're supposed to do. You play the 3K whoever it is, or the 4K running back whoever it is, and play him and take the somewhere between 15 and 30, you know what I mean? And mm-hmm. if it's 15, no big deal, you know? And if you get 30, not the end, you know, that's obviously awesome. Mm-hmm. Kittle, yeah. I'll tell you this. First of all, is Debo out again?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, dude, I mean, you invented this guy, like, when he first came in the league. But this guy, Ayuk, man, he's the man. I mean, he really is.
He both a bunch of money, by the way. He won you money, he won me a couple tournaments.
Yeah, I mean, this guy's the man. And he was kind of like just kind of in the game a little bit, but you know, he did enough in the first couple of quarters. But when they really needed to push the ball down the field, I mean, he was the guy. It was him and – no, I shouldn't say that. It was him and Kittle. Like, those were just those two guys. And that's – I just don't think they're going to – I just don't think they're going to need to do it in this game. So,
yeah.
I don't think I'll go back to that.
Look out for Kittle, though. I mean, Kittle could get two first quarter touchdowns. This is Arizona's one of the worst teams in football against the tight ends.
This could be what's his name's last game, Kingsbury.
Probably is.
And you know what? Whatever. I have my own thoughts on it. I think he's put in his best efforts. I don't think he's tanked or anything like that. I think he's tried, and I think that I don't know. I kind of like him. I don't know. I don't know what to tell you. He's always been faced with some difficulties with personnel, and I think he lands somewhere. I do. I don't know if he lands somewhere as a head coach. As an offensive coordinator. I think he makes some sense there, and I think he does like somewhere. I think he does have a good offensive mind. So I root for a guy like that. He's never pissed me off. He's just, you know, hasn't lived up to a lot of the sharp hype. You know what I mean? People thought he was a genius. Maybe he's not a genius. Maybe he's just okay. You know, whatever. But I don't mind. Anyway, this is last game. I think they're gonna play well, whatever that means. You know, they don't have too much to offer right now, so I don't know what that translates to. But you know what you can get? You still can get. I mean, are they really gonna do this? Yeah, I already see Connor questionable, right? Oh, he was spotted at practice. I mean, I don't know if they're going to give him, like, well, maybe they will give him all kinds of work. I don't know. I mean, listen, Kingsbury, he don't care. He's leaving.
That's actually a good point, by the way. We probably should have done that a little bit.
I mean, he's the leading guy. And Connor, he's like, fine, give me the ball. I'll take him. These are football players. I'll take 50 touches. They're not looking ahead to the future. Like, you're going to give me 50 touches, I'll take it, right? So I don't know if you're going to be able to do anything with it against the San Francisco defense, who, after last week, they know that they have to freaking buckle down, you know? So this is a – listen, it's tough to beat these – get to these defenses once. To get them twice, that's tough, man. And I'll tell you this, these guys do not have Davante Adams on their team. Well, they do have Hopkins is out.
Marquise Brown.
It's a rough one.
Marquise Brown is not. I mean, then you get a really cheap.
Who's the quarterback? Who's going to be the quarterback?
Is it going to be Lau, who was pretty good last week, actually.
He was all right. He was good enough.
He was, you know, not what you want as a desired total, but he played okay. He threw the ball a bunch, but then, you know, it wasn't like anything special.
All right. So let's.
This is the game that I'm most interested. Probably.
Yeah, this is the game. This is the and it's so funny. Like, even though all these games are at the same, it's funny the way our brains work. Even though all these games are at the same time, for whatever reason, because of the way these read, I feel this is like the last game on the slate.
Right.
And so I have to say that I give full props to McVay for the Rams. Okay. Listen, the fact of the matter is they won the Super Bowl. Okay. And there's not a thing that went this dude's way the whole season. Okay. And I'm not saying he did the greatest job in the world, but the team always played. They lost Cup, best player in the universe. And then Donald, second best player in the universe, or maybe tied for the best players in the universe, whatever it is. And they struggled with what to do with the running backs for a while. Cam Akers, and you probably attest to this, he's been hurt, you know, for like three quarters of the season, All right. And in the last couple of weeks, we've seen the Cam Akers that I presume that Rams fans have been waiting for, you know. And they've been playing hard. And I'll tell you this, Mayfield, if he's listen, these are the things you think about as a script writer or what are you supposed to do? Like, listen, I know that he's not going to be with the Rams next year. But he, at the end of this game, I just envision a situation where he goes in the locker room with all these guys and listen, I was like out of the league. Okay. And you guys gave me a chance, you know, and I really just appreciate all this, you know, whatever it is. Hopefully one day you guys will probably, all you guys will be trying to want to kill me. God forbid I make it with another team. I just really appreciate it. The Rams might very well have saved Mayfield's career, okay, by giving him a shot. Because he plays – listen, he's played better than pretty much all of the backups that are in the NFL, yeah, you know, yeah. In the last couple of weeks. So. And there are teams that could use him. So and listen, he humbled himself, you know, whatever it is, and he came. And I root for guys. So I hope he lands somewhere. And I think he'll play well. I think Akers will play. I think McVay will play well. You know what I mean? I think he'll coach well. I think the Rams are going to give a good effort. And Seattle has been kind of on a tailspin, but they put it together in a really, really nice game against the Jets. And I presume they have to win this one, right?
Yeah, they have to win and get healthy.
They have to win this one, and they I think you're going to get a really good game out of them. You're going to get I think Kenneth Walker is like a legit elite option at 6,400. And what do we have? Lockett, he wasn't practicing. He'll play, okay? And I think you play all three of the main skill position guys for Seattle. I'm not going to go back to the superstar, the Colby Parkinson, how many times he burns me, Fant for whatever reason also, can't quite get that main run as a tight end. I don't know why, you know? So I'll go to those guys and we talk about these matchups a lot, Rams Seattle. They're either 13-10 or 41-35. I kind of think this could be the 41-35 one. Seattle has been very, very weak except for last week, weak defensively. And I think that this really could be, if you didn't like any of that type game, and I'm kind of in here.
Yeah, I'm in on this one. I will take a little bit of a different take on, I mean, Baker's been terrible as a Ram. He had one decent game. He's been dreadful. It's just the fact that they're in games that makes him seem good. So I hope, you know, wish him the best. I hope to never see him on my team, even as a backup ever again. They literally needed to throw the ball last week and he threw the ball 19 times. He's been dreadful. There was the one good game they played against Denver. So I don't feel good about Baker in general. I know they beat the Raiders in that other game. Baker was pretty shaky in that one as well. I'm not going to play Baker, but I'm going to play every other part of this game. And I'm going to play. I actually might even end up with a Baker lineup, sadly enough. Because I know
Tutu Atwell was the other point per hour play before I forget
that. Yeah, I think Higbee's the most obvious play, yes. And Akers is the next one. Higbee, this is the 32nd is the absolute worst team of covering tight ends in football for fantasy purposes. So I'm very, very high on Higbee. And you mix in one of the, you know, the truth is we keep saying every week the Atwell or Van Jefferson, it's just as likely to be Brandon Powell. But the truth is they don't want to throw the ball enough. Like,
right.
I mean, they threw the ball 19 times in the game. They lost by 21 in their own stadium. Like,
right.
That's really weird. But I do like the Geno to Lockett and Metcalf. And you can include Fant in the mix. You can include Walker into some of your other builds where maybe you're not playing that. I really like the idea of doing that. And I will be well overweight on the Seattle stack with the runbacks of Higbee and of Cam Akers. I think that's a really good way to start off your building. And it should be, it should be fun. It's wild all over the place. I don't even want to read through my priorities because they may be completely irrelevant by the time this video gets loaded. But I will be live with you guys Sunday morning at 11 Eastern, and I hope we can crush it on the last day and make, you know, We still have no true DFS millionaire winners from this year. So we're going to have to get somebody to win one. So hopefully it's one of you guys, if it's not me, Sheets or Rody. Rasheed, anything else before we get out of here?
Nope. Stay on with me after we hit.
All right. Good luck, everybody.